I'm talking about riding pants or riding jeans. And I believe you have both, so why don't you just help us with, you know, what is what?
Okay, actually, before I go to two different kinds of riding pants, let me tell you what a lot of people are doing, you know, even the newer riders. What they do is they wear normal denims, okay, they buy riding boots and they use a strap-on armor for the knees, right, which is, in my opinion, it is not very safe.
Hang on. But, you know, again, just bring it back into context as this discussion is, because riding season is almost here and we are about to be riding and therefore we are discussing gear. Mm-hmm. If I wear armor over jeans, doesn't that give me more versatility that I don't have to, you know, go and buy some specialized equipment and I can make do? Or does it not work?
It does, but protection is paramount. When you're riding,
correct,
you should give more weightage to the protection than your, you know, convenience about using the same jean on your tour. But you must not do that. You should buy a riding pant because the denim is not made to withstand the, you know, when there is a fall, it cannot handle the scratches or.
So your
denim, even if you are wearing a denim, you should wear a riding denim.
So why don't you share,
yes,
what a riding denim is?
I'll show you what a riding denim is. This is a riding denim from a particular brand.
Sure.
Okay. And what makes it unique is it has got pockets for armor. There are some inside hip armor, which is there already. You can see it. All right. It's D3O. And it has got knee armor, which is fitted with Velcro. All right. So it doesn't move around.
Can you just take it out? So, which means,
yeah,
once you, so if I'm wearing this on a tour,
yeah,
after 8-10 hours, wherever I reach, I just, yep, take this out.
It's a normal denim for you.
Nice.
And what makes it special is it has got Kevlar in it. Right, for people who don't know what Kevlar is, it is the same material which is used in bulletproof jackets. It is fireproof.
Right,
you can't make out by seeing this, but it is actually fireproof. You see here,
that's Kevlar.
Yeah, this is Kevlar. It's actually fireproof and nothing can penetrate it, so it's quite safe whenever there is a fall. It has to have Kevlar. So this has got Kevlar up till your knees, and this area, this portion doesn't have any Kevlar because you anyway wear riding boots, which are taller.
Now, see, again, and consistently this is coming up, knowledge and information.
Yeah.
Now, I imagine this is what, 9,000?
Yeah, 8,000 something.
Now, a regular pair of jeans, mm-hmm, is about whatever, 1500 till 4000 for most brands. If I'm asking someone to buy this riding jeans for 9000 rupees, the reason I'm saying is for a new rider or for a young rider, you know, 9000 rupees is a lot of money.
Correct.
But unfortunately, not enough knowledge or information is out there of why you should invest this. Like today, all that you've, you know, said, whether it's D3O, armor, or Kevlar, somehow they feel that this is an investment which is not worth it. But
yes,
is it a worthwhile investment?
In my opinion, yes it is.
How?
Because nothing is going to happen to this riding pant, okay? For the next 5 years, I don't think I'm sorted. I don't want anything.
And if I'm not mistaken, I think one of our friends took a fall on GFR wearing this.
Yes.
And he walked off.
Correct. Nothing happened to him. So it is protecting me. You know, 9,000 rupees is nothing in front of my life.
In the event of a fall, like that fellow fell,
yeah,
if he had been wearing normal jeans, most probably the jeans would have ripped.
Correct.
Because of the rubble and whatever,
yes,
is on the ground.
So, absolutely. So that is where riding jeans, if you are you know, thinking about fashion first and form,
see, it's not
function
about,
later.
It's not about fashion. There is, again, like I said, we are still, our journey into gear is still young.
Yes.
So we usually think helmet, jacket,
yeah,
and
boots, and then riding pants.
Correct.
And sometimes no gloves.
And riding and riding pants kind of comes the very last, or doesn't come at all.
Doesn't come at all, right?
Okay. I can see another pair.
Yes,
of
there's another type of trouser which is very popular among tourers, and these are the riding pants, which is essentially made of the same material as your jackets, right? This is called a textile mesh material. Right, this has got like, okay, now see here, this has got mesh right here and on the knees. The pockets of armor are inside, okay, and it has got mesh here also, so there is enough ventilation.
I mean, personally, I would be happier with the riding jeans than this. Yeah. Because this, while this is more specialized, it's just yet another thing to wear.
Correct. How also, the riding denim, it I don't have to carry an extra pair of denims with me. I can use them.
Also assuming, just correct me if I'm wrong, that riding denims, because it's cotton and we are predominantly a hot country.
Yeah.
Is there a difference in comfort between the two as far as heat and rain is concerned?
See, okay, like that has an advantage of having Kevlar in it, but Kevlar gets very, very hot, you know, when you're wearing in summer season or humidity. So in peak summer, Kevlar jeans won't help you.
Okay. September is almost over.
Yeah.
Riding season is right here.
Yes.
Between the two.
Yeah.
Pick one. And why?
This one. Because cold. I have to carry one less pair of jeans. Plus Kevlar keeps me warm. And I'm comfortable. I find them more comfortable.
But in peak winter, I will need to either layer up or
layer
under.
Yes. I need to have a base layer under it.
Got it. Fair enough. Makes sense. What's next?
Next up is riding boots.
Got it.
Okay. Talk about boots. All right, Ashish, I've got a few pair of boots with me. Sorry, these are a bit dirty. But these are essentially touring boots. You can see. And these are full, completely leather and waterproof.
What are touring boots?
Okay. Now, a touring boot is wider from the front. Okay. So that's it's easier on long tours. You can wear them the entire day and you don't get tired, right? And they should be waterproof because you never know when you are doing some water crossing or something. This patch is for your gear.
Okay, right?
This side. Right. And honestly speaking, I don't know why do they give it this side because it's essentially for the brake.
Right?
Yeah, perhaps to keep the symmetry. Hmm. So talking about protection, this is of course the toe is reinforced with some metal. And you've got protection on the side, you've got protection on the ankles, and of course protection here. So you're pretty much protected along with the heel.
And it's got reflective. I like the wide mouth.
Yeah, it's quite wide, quite comfortable. But yes, when it rains, a lot of water can seep in from here, though they are waterproof. But that is one problem that I found in these. No matter how much tight you do, still the water can seep in.
Okay.
Okay, now these are another set of boots. These are mainly for adventure touring. These are what clasps. So, you know, there are more chances of falling down when you're doing trails and off-roading. So these clasps, they keep your foot safe. No, nothing will happen. They'll not come out. All right. Talking about protection, again, the toe, the ankle and the heel.
So, if you can just get one boot of your earlier touring boot, just one of this and
okay.
one of this.
All right. I just want to show the comparison. Yes.
Yes. So, now, just walk us through. See, adventure touring is still relatively a new concept in India.
Correct.
From a point of view of why I need boots, and therefore, what are the subtle differences? And also, how much of your decision to buy is influenced by looks and how much by performance?
Okay. So, I think I can take this question as which is a do-it-all boot for me.
Nice.
Right? This.
Why?
It can do everything. It is taller. You're doing adventure touring. No problem at all. It is still safe. It is waterproof. Again, for adventure touring, for your normal touring, for rain, of course it is a bit wider from the mouth is a bit wider, but still it is better.
Comfort?
Comfort wise, both are approximately same, almost same. See, they're quite wide.
And the difference in pricing?
Same, similarly priced. This is for 15,000, this is for 14,000. But I prefer these because these are taller. And they also protect you from a lot of engine heat from the motorcycle.
I've actually started, you know, my boot height is also increasing because I've noticed, especially on highways, given the fact that there is so much construction going
Correct.
On, constantly, you know, you're getting these pebbles and stones hitting
yes.
your legs.
Yeah. So, taller your boot, better it is.
Again, asking from a point of view of, we ride a lot, but we also put ourselves what other people call discomfort. Now in peak summer,
yeah,
or it's 37 degrees outside today, wearing these kind of boots is not exactly a walk in the park.
Yeah.
So, I this is again a conversation which, you know, happens every day literally.
Yeah.
That I am an experienced rider, therefore for me kites are okay.
The answer is no.
Why?
Kites are not okay. No other shoe, other than the proper touring or proper motorcycling boot, they're not suitable because whenever there's a fall, you need reinforcement in the shoe. You need protection on your ankles, on your heel, on your toe. You need protection. And those shoes don't have protection. They are not meant for motorcycling.
Have you ever been in a situation where the boot got tested?
Yes. On my very first ride. Very first ride to the mountains, I was riding a lower capacity motorcycle. And as soon as I saw the twisties, I went mad. Because I like, you know, maneuvering my motorcycle on twisties. I didn't know how to control steer my motorcycle then, and as any new rider.
So you fell?
I didn't fall, but I went into a ditch because I couldn't manage the motorcycle to move right. Right? Went into a ditch and I tried to manage my weight, and you know, I can't show my foot right now, but what happened was my left foot, you know, it went
stuck under the bike.
It went like this.
Got it.
And suddenly I took it out. Had I been wearing normal sport shoe or a sneaker, I would have broken something. My left foot would have gone, but nothing happened.
So it's worth the investment.
And honestly, I'm telling you, those were not Alpine Stars or any other brand. Those were just standard military boots, and only the protection saved me. Also, Ashish, I wonder, there are a lot of people, they use trekking boots for motorcycling. You know, they go to some departmental big store and they buy some brand which is made for, because of course that has also got some reinforcement on the ankle and the toe, and they think it is suitable for the motorcycle. Is it so?
Not at all. Yes, you're absolutely right. In fact, every possible second ride there will be at least two guys wearing either trekking waterproof boots.
Yeah.
Or, I hate saying it, but there is no other way of describing it, some of the boots that the forces wear, because they kind of look, you know, like macho and they look the business.
Yeah.
They have protection on the toe. But understand one thing, motorcycling is a specialist sport.
Correct.
And these boots have been designed for special events. Now, just to tell you, there's a metal shank here.
Mm-hmm.
So when for a long period of time, when your foot is on the peg, minus the shank, your foot gets tired.
Correct.
Then this is like an accordion stretch.
Yeah.
So especially when your foot goes in, you need to flex it. Which is why in most boots, laces are not there, because one, if you have laces, some brands do have laces,
yeah.
Water will go in, wind will go in, and it's
well, it hampers the flexibility as well.
It's just cumbersome.
Mm.
Then this adjusts, is, you know, comfort as per you. And all of this area, this is armored.
Mm.
This protects your ankle, because understand the ankle bone area.
Yeah.
Is an extremely delicate area, and God forbid you have a fall and the bike is over you.
Mm.
If you don't have protection here,
yeah,
the foot is going to get crushed.
Correct.
And then there is protection here. Plus the quality of leather, the quality of stitching, you literally need a tank to go through it.
So nothing will happen to it.
Now, again, you know, it's unfortunately, it comes down to personal choice, because there is no legislation on it. Making your feet wear such boots makes good sense.
Correct.
Because also what's happening is, if you're riding 500-600 kilometers, assume that you will be going from tarmac to some off-road to either desert or mountain or water. Your boots and your feet will encounter 4 to 5 different kinds of situations.
Correct.
That's a given.
That happens, yes.
Now, if I am not wearing a specialist motorcycling boot, somewhere I'm compromising.
Right.
Either they'll get wet if I'm wearing an ordinary boot. Sneakers are always, you know, usually this height, which means everything that's happening.
My ankle
here
is exposed, yeah.
Ankle is exposed, shin is exposed.
And you're wearing a denim without Kevlar or any protection.
So, you know, motorcycling, while yes, it's a fun sport, some call it glamorous too, it is also a demanding sport.
It is.
Because as we've discussed, you know, you do need specialist gear, and if you want to ride without the tension of, you know, will I survive
and get the fall? Yeah.
And many say it, you know, you have to always prepare for the worst.
True.
It's not that people are falling every day.
No, it's like dress for the crash.
Correct. No, God forbid if it happens and if you are wearing KEDs. In fact, some call me obsessive. And I am obsessive because many years back I had a terrible crash and I broke my collarbone. Now I don't even go out 1 kilometer without wearing riding.
That's a great thing.
So at times it becomes difficult because 45 degrees outside, you're on your bike, and anyway, people doubt your sanity.
Yeah.
Then on top of that, you're wearing riding gear. So it's a, you know, comes down to personal preference, but we would always recommend please gear up.
Yeah.
But before we go away, those are some very good looking boots that I see.
As any other riding gear of mine. Yeah. These are also very special boots. These are completely leather boots and made for modern classic motorcycles. Right, these are made by Triumph. And
do they have protection?
Yes, they do have protection. They've got metal reinforcements here and they have got some extra leather here just for your gear shifts.
Okay.
Right, and they've got protection on your heel as well.
They look quite comfortable.
Yeah, I'm not too sure whether they have a metal shank here. I don't know, but perhaps they are made for riding.
You can open them.
Not so soon. Okay. All right, but they cannot stand touring because as you see, this is full leather. And this leather doesn't seem to be very tough for your kinds of terrain.
So we'll test it.
We can test it. But I would use them in the city.
That's so, just to wrap up, all the pairs that we've seen.
Yeah.
This seems to be...
The choice. Yeah. This or any other similar kind of a touring boot.
And would it be fair to summarize? See, there are lots of options now.
Mm-hmm.
And there are options from, I think, 4,000 rupees going up to 70,000 rupees. What's the argument for youngsters? Or what's the recommendation for youngsters that gear up as per your pocket? Or is there a minimum spec you want them to meet?
Okay.
See, there because is... it's also a bit like chasing rainbows.
Correct. As I say, there's no end to it, right? You can keep on spending on and on, but you may not reach your final destination because it's all here.
Sure.
All right. Of course, pocket has to be considered, but what you should be bothered about is not how the boot looks, you know, what is the purpose which is being served by the boot. So my advice to any new rider or a youngster is what he should look for in a boot. It should have metal reinforcements on the toe,
Sure. On
the ankle, on the heel. It should be tall enough so that your shin is protected. It should be waterproof because in touring, there are a lot of uncertainties, so you need to have a waterproof boot.
Now, quick question here, and this also comes up.
Mm-hmm.
And this is an assumption, mm-hmm. rather a presumption.
Mm-hmm.
These don't look too comfortable. Before you answer, because you know, many people are giving this argument today that even if you take this, you need to carry a pair of KEDs. I have a personal experience, but I'll hold that back. I just want you to give your experience. Last ride,
mm-hmm.
I noticed these were the only boots that you had.
Yeah.
So, were you uncomfortable walking around everywhere?
No, I wasn't. These are quite comfortable.
So, which means you can actually take this as the only pair of footwear.
Yes.
If on a ride, because rider's eternal problem, space.
Correct. You can wear these and keep them for all the days.
And just before we go off, you know, you mentioned fashion.
Yeah.
Now, if we just look at compare the heights of the two.
Mm-hmm.
For touring, specifically for touring, what is the minimum length that you would recommend of the boot?
I'm not really sure how tall is it, but this is certainly 3 inches taller than this, right? And this probably is 12 inches tall.
See, because the reason I'm saying it is, the taller the boot, it takes some time to grow into them.
Yeah.
Because they are a little uncomfortable to start.
It is. They are.
So,
yeah.
Is this what you want or is this what you want?
I want this because, as I said, this also protects me from the engine heat of my motorcycle.
Ah.
So, above this, I anyway have my knee armor. So, I'm very well protected from the heat.
Okay, guys, so you've heard it from the bootman himself. We have to boot up or don't suit up. So, guys, that was all about boots in conversation with Sumit Berry. We'll wrap up this episode here now. And as always, if you have any questions,
please write to sumit@happinessperkm.com. Don't forget to click like, share, and subscribe to our YouTube channel, which is also called Happiness Per KM. Thanks for watching.